Gracious and loving God, we thank you and we praise you. We ask that you pour your blessings upon us, that you pour your Holy Spirit upon us as we join together this morning. We ask that you bless the words of our mouths and the thoughts of our minds. May all that we do and all that we say be holy and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Through Christ our Lord we pray. It takes a lot to make me angry. I'm not the kind of person that loses my temper easily. I'm not the kind of person that can be easily offended. When I say that it takes a lot to get me angry, believe me. But then Wednesday night, I made the big mistake of going onto Facebook. It was a huge mistake because after the massacre on Sunday, early Sunday morning, Facebook was covered with lots of things having to do with the Orlando shooting, and one person happened to share a video of a pastor, I'm going to call this person a pastor, who preached that Sunday morning, just hours after the massacre, preached in California about how we shouldn't be sad that 49 people were killed. How we shouldn't be sad, but he actually praised the actions of the gunman. I listened to this Christian pastor preach this horrific message about essentially praising the fact that people were killed. And then since it was on Facebook, it so kindly recommended other videos like that for me to watch. And so I watched another video of another Christian pastor saying just about the same thing, saying that we shouldn't be upset, we shouldn't be sad, instead we should be okay with the fact that 50 people were just killed. Friends, it does not take much, or it takes a lot to get me angry. I'm not the kind of person that easily gets angry, but I can tell you that after watching these videos, my blood started to boil. I could feel my blood inside of me starting to boil. I could feel that anger rising. It's like my head felt hot. I was so angry after listening to these pastors spew these hate-filled messages. And then the words of Jesus when he talks about false prophets started echoing into my head, and I started realizing how much danger these men were doing. How much danger they were doing by spreading these hate-filled messages all in the name of Christ. But on Tuesday night, four of us from Zion went over to one of our sister churches, St. Stephen's Bethlehem, and we went over there for a prayer vigil for the Orlando victims. And we were there, and we lit candles, and we prayed, and we sang songs, and then members of the congregation, as we were all gathered in a circle outside, members of the congregation started saying the names and the ages of the 49 victims who died, including Louis Velma, 22, Yilmari Solomon, 24, Enrique Rios, 25, Alejandro Martinez, 21, Jason Josephat, 19, Akira Murray, 18. Most of the victims were in between the ages of 18 and 25. They were still babies. They were still so young, and yet these people stood up, and one of them preached a sermon, others shared YouTube videos, saying that we should not be sad that they were killed. Saying that we should not be sad at all. Friends, it's heartbreaking. The oldest victim who died in the massacre was 49-year-old Brenda McCool, who was there with her son, and she laid on top of her son and protected him so that she died, so that she took the bullets to keep him alive. I get so angry when I hear Christians spewing hate. Not much can actually make me angry, but I get so angry when I hear Christians spewing hate because it's not our job as followers of Christ to judge. It is not our job as followers of Christ to hate. In fact, it goes against every single thing that Christ teaches us when we spew hate. Being a Christian isn't about upholding those 613 laws of Moses. You know, the Ten Commandments, they're good. But being a Christian is not about upholding those other 613 world. And so Paul writes to them, and he's trying to get them to see eye to eye and get them to learn how to live together. And I love how in this part of Paul's letter, he gives us this wonderful tribute about what it means to really be a follower of Christ, what it means to really be a Christian. And he says to them, no matter what's going on, let your love be genuine. Hate what is evil. By the way, preaching about praising the massacre, you know, those preachers that were praising the massacre, that's not hating what is evil, that's loving what is evil. Paul said, hate what is evil, love one another with mutual affection, outdo one another in showing honor, bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony and do not repay evil for evil. Paul's words here are good. In the wake of this tragedy, or realistically in the wake of what seems like a week of tragedies, it's important to read these words about what it means to be a Christian. Because friends, whether you have been a believer for your entire life or you just came to faith last week, that does not determine whether or not you can be a Christian. Whether you have lived a perfectly good, straight and narrow life, or whether you've kind of been more like the prodigal son, that does not determine whether or not you can be a Christian. Whether you are gay or straight or uncertain, that does not determine whether or not you can be a Christian. Being a Christian is all about following Christ. It's all about loving people no matter what. It's all about loving God and loving others. It's about repaying evil with mercy. It's about kindness and compassion and faith and love. Being a Christian has nothing to do with hate and judgment. It has everything to do with love. People spewing hate in the name of Christ is as far from Christ-like as someone can possibly be. And friends, it angered me this week. It angered me to hear Christians spewing hate in the name of Christ. And we've got to face the fact that if there are other people out there spewing hate, that makes our job even more important. It makes our job as loving Christians to let the world know that they are loved by God. To let the world know that they are truly loved by God. And I am thankful that there was one Christian, there's many, but there was one Christian that I was really honored by his actions after the wake of what happened in Orlando. And I'm going to let you watch this brief two-minute news segment about this man that I'm talking about. He understands what it means to be a Christian. I'll let you watch this.
Air Force, Carrie Cobb.
Carrie is live in Orlando with more now and a special memorial put up for the 49 victims of the Pulse nightclub shooting. Carrie.
Yeah, amidst all the pain and suffering here in Orlando, we have seen some signs of hopefulness and love. In fact, we saw 49 of those signs today in the form of 49 wooden crosses put up by a man named Greg Zanis.
Greg Zanis' hands are full with wooden crosses that he made to each of the 49 Pulse nightclub shooting victims. His heart is full, too, of hope.
My message today is love your brother, love your neighbor, don't judge.
Zanis drove 1,200 miles from Illinois to place these crosses along a lake outside the Orlando Health Medical Center. He's traveled to the scene of many tragedies.
I went to Newtown, put a 26 there.
Wherever there's a mass murder, Zanis tries to show up days later.
I got markers here if you want to start writing on them.
He hopes his crosses give people a place to share a message and offer their personal condolences.
Wait till you see these in a week, you won't even see the hearts. You know what I mean? It'll be a major focal point.
His generosity and caring touched those who witnessed his act of kindness.
I think it's absolutely beautiful and breathtaking that he drove 1,200 miles to come and bring these crosses here.
Zanis said his father-in-law was murdered 20 years ago, and since that day, he stopped building houses and started building crosses. He believes they're a symbol of something this community needs right now.
Just offering hope in a very hopeless situation.
Such a kind thing to do. Zanis told me that after people have a chance to write on those crosses and leave their messages of condolence, he plans to give each of those crosses to the victims' families. Live in Orlando, Carrie Cott, CBS 4 News.
Friends, let me ask you, if we are to compare those pastors that I heard preaching hate-filled messages and compare this man who drove 1,200 miles to deliver crosses, who's doing a better job of following Christ? A man. It's not even a competition. Now, I remember 20 years ago, I was at the Holocaust Museum with my 8th grade class. And we did whatever, you know, it's what my school does in 8th grade, probably many other schools. You know, go down to the Holocaust Museum and tour through the museum. At the end, you end up finding if this person on this car that you've been carrying lived or died. And then we went into this room with our teachers to debrief. And in that room, we also met this woman right up here. Her name is Nessie Godin. We met her. She meets many students that go into the Holocaust Museum, and she talked with us, and she told us about her story, how she was a Holocaust survivor, and she told us her heartbreaking story, but also a story that included she made it out alive so she could tell us the story, and then she took our questions. She took the questions of all of us 8th graders that were gathered there that day, and even though it was 20 years ago, I still remember exactly what the question was that my Now Gavin, he's a kind of littler, very hyperactive guy, and he's been one of my friends forever, and he just happened to say, he's like, "Do you hate Nazis?" "Yes, Nessie does." And Mrs. Godin, being that she's very grandmotherly, she, instead of answering his question directly, she answered it with a story. She said, "I was babysitting my grandkids the other day, and I'm feeding them dinner, and so I made them spaghetti, and the youngest one was sitting in the high chair, and I gave him his spaghetti, and then he picked up the spaghetti, and he threw it, and he said, 'I hate spaghetti.'" She said, "How can you hate spaghetti? What did spaghetti ever do to you? And what good is hating spaghetti going to do any of us?" And then she said that she doesn't like the word hate. She doesn't like to use the word hate. She doesn't like when anybody uses the word hate, because hate creates more hate. Hate never leads to peace. Instead, hate creates more and more hate. And the other day, I hope you had a chance to listen to the Reverend Justo Gonzalez, to his interview on NPR the other day. Well, he is the pastor of Pilgrim St. Luke. He's a UCC pastor. And he spoke at the vigil in Buffalo, and then he also spoke to NPR, and he was on the news. Well, he echoed Mrs. Godin's message the other day. Now, Reverend Gonzalez is Latino and gay, and he's a pastor, and just a few years ago, he moved here from Orlando. He did not know any of the victims, but he knew, has friends there who did know the victims. And he echoed exactly what Mrs. Godin said the other day. He echoed what the Holocaust survivor said when he said, you know, when he was asked on behalf of the gay and Latino community what he wants to say, what message he wants to spread. He says that we need to stop the rhetoric of hate that is so prevalent today. He said, if we want to make a difference, then we need to stop the rhetoric of hate that is so prevalent today. We need to stop the rhetoric of hate that leads one person to feel as though it's okay to tear down another person. We need to stop the rhetoric of hate that makes LGBTQ folks feel like they're not welcome in church. We need to stop the rhetoric of hate that destructs communities. We need to stop the rhetoric of hate that makes room for and allows bigotry. We need to stop the rhetoric of hate that is so pervasive in this society. We need to stop it now, otherwise more of our young people are going to feel endangered. The LGBTQ teens are the largest group of those who suicide and who are victims of violence. We need to do something. Because, friends, truthfully, the Church Universal, I mean, this church is wonderful and loving, but the Church Universal has kind of failed a lot of our folks. We tell people that they're not welcome. We tell people that they're not loved. We tell people these hate-filled messages. Even if it's not us, it's the Church Universal, it's the Christian Church. We spread this message of hate, and it does so much damage, and it destroys. distracts people from Christ. When followers of Christ are not supposed to, by any means, be hate-filled or judgmental, you know this, I know, but followers of Christ need to be the most loving people in this entire world. Followers of Christ need to outdo one another in showing honor. I love those words of Paul. Followers of Christ need to welcome the oppressed, the ostracized, and the afflicted. So friends, as we reflect on what happened just 1 week ago in Orlando, I'm here to say that all of us, myself included, we all need to do better on behalf of the church. We all need to stop the rhetoric of hate. We need to not let it be spoken, and instead we need to speak words of love. We need to make sure that everybody knows that no matter who they are, no matter what they've done, no matter who they've been, no matter anything, that they are loved. That they're loved by God. That they're loved by us. Friends, I don't know about you, but I know I want to do better. Do you want to do better? Then we've got our work to do. Because there are people out there speaking loudly in the name of Christ. And they are saying words of hate. We need to be ready to let people know that they are loved, that they are welcome, that they are accepted. Or else something like Orlando is going to happen again. Let us join in a moment of prayer. Gracious and loving God, you are a God of love. You are a God who loves us even when we don't deserve it. Lord, we confess that we have made mistakes. We confess that we have not been as loving as we ought to be. We confess that we have allowed for hatred and bigotry to exist. We confess our sins, and Lord, we turn over to you and we ask that you help us to do better. Help us to be more loving. Help us to share your love with the world. Help us to show people Christ. Lord, we ask that you bless us and empower us to do what is right, to be followers of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we give thanks and praise for all that you have done in our lives. And we ask that you lead us and guide us. And we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.